And with all of the media attention, I think they're getting the story wrong. I think our corporate media is truly screwed up these days. But while they're focusing on, you know, Bradley Manning and Edward Snowden's personalities and that, instead of the information that they released to us, I think one story that the media has shied away from is of Aaron Swartz. And he worked for you. And Aaron Swartz, for those who say, wait, why, that name sounds familiar, committed suicide, basically, because he was being targeted by the government over something that I don't even know enough about, the, you know, into the weeds of this story. But this was government overreach, going after a kid who was a great, you know, a technical genius dealing with the internet, but he wasn't doing anything that would put national security at risk. He wasn't doing anything that I can tell so heinous. What it seems to me he was doing was getting scholarly records from, I think it was MIT, that were available publicly anyway and making them more publicly accessible. And for that, the DOJ was going after him in a big way, and he wound up committing suicide. What can you tell us about Aaron Swartz and what happened to him?
Well, Aaron was one of the founders of Reddit, which is a very widely used internet sharing service became popular, and he founded it. He created that service when he was 14 years old.
Oh my!
It just amazingly talented programmer and political strategist. Mm-hmm. He decided to use his knowledge of computers in order to essentially protect and extend our liberty. And he was very concerned about the closed systems that were being set up that would allow people to restrict access to the Internet. From his perspective, the Internet was a dramatic change in how we relate to each other. And I know this because he worked in our office for a while. He's an intern.
Right.
And I got to know him reasonably well. And every time now an intern works in our office, I say to myself, this could be the next Aaron Swartz. So they get treated very nicely. But in any event, Aaron knew that the Internet could evolve in two different possible ways. One way that it could evolve was that it would remain free to everybody, and that it would be a device for everyone to communicate with everyone based upon the power and strength of their ideas. And the second way was that the Internet could evolve in a way that meant that giant multinational corporations could end up controlling it and dominating the information that we see. So picture the possibility that Facebook would basically edit and exclude certain political ideas. I'm not saying Facebook does that. I'm saying right. Facebook could do it. Mm-hmm. Has the capability of doing it. Hasn't done it yet. But it could just say, you know, if you post something liberal on our website, we're going to delete it. So there's an ongoing struggle between proprietary systems, closed systems, and open systems. And Aaron was a vigorous proponent of open systems. So getting back to what you were referring to, after he was an intern in our office, Aaron got very interested in scientific research because his belief was that it's paid for largely by the public. The public is far and away the biggest sponsor of scientific research by a wide margin. And in addition to that, it's done by institutions that are nonprofit institutions. Generally speaking, the government pays for college professors and other people at nonprofit institutions, like health clinics, to do research. And then they claim, or some of them claim, that the information belongs to them rather than belonging to the public. So with that in mind, Aaron downloaded a large number of scientific scholarly publications from a source called JSTOR, J-S-T-O-R. Government found out about it. The government decided to prosecute him for computer tampering, and did so even though the government seems to be perfectly happy to be spying on every single American
right.
and sending a copy of the information about every call that we make to the Defense Department and the NSA. I mean, the irony just is overwhelming here. So Aaron downloads a bunch of scientific articles, and he gets prosecuted for it. The NSA tracks every single telephone call that we make, and somehow that's all okay. So after he did this, he was prosecuted. He had accumulated a certain amount of money in the course of his endeavors for Reddit and otherwise. It all went to the lawyers. He was facing a situation where they would not let him take any reasonable plea bargain, even though he had no criminal record. And, you know, we have instances of people literally committing murder and spending less than a year in prison. In Aaron's case, for downloading a bunch of scholarly articles, they wanted him to spend hard time in prison. They would have taken away from him the thing he loved the most, which is his ability to create, his ability to program, his ability to be a computer whiz. And they would have had him basically doing prison laundry for 5 years and impoverishing him in the process. And it was just too much for him, so he committed suicide.
And nobody is going to be punished for that. Just like, you know, we see Bradley Manning, of course. We don't know what he's going to be sentenced to, but I don't think he'll be seeing sunshine anytime soon. We see Edward Snowden, who, I don't know your feelings on these guys, but, you know, someone who I think put his life and livelihood at risk to expose what he saw as wrongdoing on the part of the government. I know you agree
Edward
on that.
Edward Snowden is a classic whistleblower, as the term is normally understood. In March of this year, we had James Clapper, who was the head of National Intelligence, testify under oath that no records were being kept on millions of Americans by the NSA. And that turned out to be a blatant lie, an absolute blatant lie. Among other things, the phone records alone, the fact that every phone call you make, the information, the metadata from that call is given to the NSA, means that the NSA has files on these Americans, but literally every American with a telephone. Every American with a telephone has what amounts to an NSA file based upon their telephone number. And Clapper just flat out lied about it. And to show how malevolent the system has become, the day after he lied about it, one of the staffers contacted the Senate staffer, who was responsible for the question that had been asked, and because his boss had asked the question, the senator asked the question, Senator Wyden. And he contacted him and said, by the way, Clapper knows that he misspoke yesterday.
Oh.
And by the way, what I'm telling you now is reported widely.
Oh, yes. No, right.
He knows that he misspoke yesterday. However, the fact that I'm contacting you and letting you know that he misspoke is itself classified. And you can't tell anybody that I'm telling you that he knows he misspoke.
Oh, my God.
That's how ridiculous the system has become at this point. That lying to the American public is okay, but acknowledging that you just lied to the American public somehow is secret.
Right.
Snowden sees all this. He's told people that this was his motivation. Snowden sees this. He sees this is happening. He knows that it's utterly false. He knows that the program is wildly unconstitutional. It doesn't have particularity. It assumes people are guilty without any question of their innocence. Not just people, but everyone. We're all guilty until proven innocent. And there's no probable cause, so it's like blatant, extreme violation of the Constitution on an almost unbelievable scale, affecting every American with a telephone. So Snowden says, "I can't let this go on." So he leaks a copy of the court order that allows, supposedly, rationalizes this program, and allows them to do this. That was the first document that he leaked that was published, was the court order. To Verizon, saying Verizon, turn over all of your phone records to the government,
right,
to the NSA. I mean, if that's not whistleblowing, what is?
Well, good question. And then we have this administration who has gone after, pursued, and prosecuted more whistleblowers than all the other administrations combined. And I don't understand that.
The president was recently asked about this, and it was not a public event, is a private event.
Okay.
But I have to tell you what he said. You know, he was asked about the domestic spying program and the criticism of it. And he said the criticism of it was BS, except he didn't use the letters BS.
Right.
And it just shows you how disconnected he is. This former professor of constitutional about the fact that the Defense Department is collecting massive amounts of information about ordinary Americans who've done nothing wrong and have no connection to terrorism. He literally just doesn't seem to understand what the problem is.
Oh,
and it's shocking to me. This, at one point, he literally taught law students about what the Fourth Amendment is, and he doesn't seem to get it.
It is stunning, but he's also the guy who, I guess it was at that same meeting, I'm just guessing, that he gave this great defense of Larry Summers, who, I'm sorry, if he names Larry Summers as the next chair of the Fed, I say, it's time to, I don't know, find an island somewhere, because he doesn't get it. He certainly doesn't represent me.
You know, there's a new term that's coming into wide use. It's called larrying.
Larrying.
Larry Summers has become a verb.
Oh, to
larry.
My God.
And when you larry something, what it is when a very, very bright person consistently screws up. that's what it means to larry.
I'm sure he's quite brilliant, but he's a screw-up, and I certainly don't want
to
turn him.
And you listen to the president sort of try to rationalize this, and the president said, well, he was in the trenches with me, and we faced the biggest economic crisis. Yes, but he gave really, really bad advice that has dramatically slowed our recovery from that recession. That's the bottom line.
Right.
You can't judge people by whether they're in the trenches with you or not. You have to judge people by the quality of their judgment. And his judgment is horrible. They took the largest endowment of any university in America and cut it by 40%. What's he going to do, cut our GNP by 40% as well? It's horrifying to think that somebody with like a relentlessly miserable track record, leaving aside his misogyny, a relentlessly, an unbroken record of utter failure, would fail upward to the point where he's controlling the entire U.S. economy.